Thank you so much for coming in this afternoon. It's an absolute pleasure and delight to welcome Tony Vidler back to the AA, who was with us, I think, a little over a year ago, I want to say. Tony would have been in for a presentation of his work on the Stirling archive. And it's a recent visit since then. And Tony's been very, very supportive of the AA in so many different ways over the years. One of the wonderful things about schools and institutions is that they can create their own traditions. And one of our traditions is that as Tony is working on ideas, he brings them to this room and this audience in different forms and has been doing so for very many years. Indeed, and he tells me that a first visit here in 1972 was when that tradition began, and he presented chapters that became his Writing of the Walls book, published in 1980, and this is an opportunity today for Tony to do the same, to present things that he's working on as he speaks today, and his current work includes, you could say, rumination over the state of architectural theory, especially today. The role, presence, and impact of theory, not just in architecture as we know it now, but as theory has shaped architectural culture as we know it for the last half century or more, which is what he'll be highlighting in today's talk titled Troubles in Theory. The State of Architecture, History, Criticism, and Theory. Tony is is Dean and Professor of the Irwin S. Chanin School of Architecture at the Cooper Union in New York, as many of you know. His most recent book, The Scenes of the Street and Other Essays, was published in 2011 and is, of course, only the most recent of many texts on the state of architecture and its culture. His book published in late 2010, titled James Frazer Stirling, Notes from the Archive, was the occasion of his last visit, as I mentioned, and the accompanying monograph for one of the great architectural exhibitions of our time. Currently, I think, just coming down or still up in Europe?
No, it's taken down from the Staatsgalerie. It's now back at the Canadian Centre for Architecture. We'll
in
be
Montreal.
Opening in Montreal on May 15th.
In May 15th.
Much expanded.
Much expanded. For those of you that had a chance to see a version of that show here at the Tate, before going on to the Stirling Museum in Stuttgart. In 2008, Tony's book, Histories of the Immediate Present, Inventing Architectural Modernism, was published, I believe, by MIT Press. 2 years prior to that, Claude-Nicolas Ledoux, Architecture and Utopia in the Era of the French Revolution. A few years before that, Warped Space, Art, Architecture, and Anxiety in Modern Culture are three of many, many titles whose keywords alone, which include things like culture, architecture, anxiety, histories, and the present, I think offer evidence, unlike any other career, of the ways in which different parts of the architecture world can be connected, and I think done in ways probably more profoundly by Tony and his work as a historian than anyone else we know. Please join me in welcoming back Tony Vidler.
Gotcha.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brett, very much for that. It has to be said that I started lecturing here, yes, in 1972, but I was only 5 years old, and so ever young, right?
Yes.
So troubles in theory. I started to think about troubles in theory. It's the second time I thought about troubles in theory, actually. The first time was when Sandy Wilson at Cambridge in 1965 handed me triumphantly. He said, what he said was the theory of theories to kill all theories, Christian Norberg Schultz's intentions in architecture. So I read it dutifully, and after the 175 pages which comprised intentions in architecture, I realized that this was but a very weak attempt at either theory and a theory to kill all theories, and that it must be an attempt to dispel a lot of anxiety and worries and troubles underneath the real theories which were emerging at the time. I thought about this thought the second time when somebody a few days ago handed me a large, white, thick volume of 425 pages, which purported to be a comprehensive, unified theory of and for architecture. Dutifully, I read the 425 pages plus some matrices, some appendices, and some theses. And I realized that theory was in real trouble, precisely because someone had realized that in order to deal with the troubling nature of theory, a unified and comprehensive theory, which in the end is, I'm afraid to say, nothing of the sort, had to be written. We await the second volume. So, I give you then two quotations. We lack a satisfactory theory of architecture. That's Christian Norberg Schultz, 1965. And a comprehensive unified theory of and for architecture is important. No one has attempted a unified theory since Le Corbusier, and perhaps since the book The International Style, or perhaps since the work of Christian Norberg Schultz, and then, save me, Patrick Schumacher, Parametricism. Architectural theory has taken many forms since Vitruvius. What I'm going to do today is give you the shortest theory of the history of theory that I can give you in an hour. But in order to talk about centrally the notion of theory that has emerged since the Second World War. Now, I'm writing this book now for Oxford University Press, and I've actually been writing it, I mean, Mark Cousins knows, for about 10 years now. And it's a history of the sort of the present condition of architecture, which I start in 1945. And with the end of the Second World War and the beginning of all the other wars, the Cold War, the Korean War, the Vietnam War, wars in the Middle East, followed by the Iraq War, followed by the Afghanistan War, followed by perhaps quite soon the Iran War. So wars have not gone away, and I have the feeling that all the troubles in architectural theory, in fact, architecture itself, have been driven by wars. The economy of wars has produced the economy of the global market, which has produced the economy that drives architecture, which has produced the need for theories that accommodate or sometimes resist that global market. So, in writing this work, I find that many histories of architecture since 1945 completely ignore the war, certainly the Second World War and all the other wars since. In fact, they only talk about the war in terms of post-war reconstruction or post-war rehabilitation or something like that. And it is my thesis and the thesis of my friend Jean-Louis Cullen and my other very close friend and colleague, Beatrice Colomina, that the war had much more powerful an effect, not just on the economy of reconstruction and architecture, but also on the theory of architecture, hence the notion of anxiety, which I place front and foremost in my understanding of architectural theory. Architectural theory always, for me, being a mode of warding off or accepting or dealing with anxiety of one form or another. So in this very short lecture, I'm going to concentrate very much on the period between 1945 and the present, and we are going to concentrate on theories of architecture which I think have been proposed on the basis of a series of visual concepts, a series of visual understandings about architecture that were formulated between 1940 and 1945, and which have continued to operate within the architectural paradigm. Visual theories, not theories of program, not theories of serious interior interrogation of the architectural object, but theories of visual perception. So, just a very quick resume of architectural theory. Architectural theory has taken many forms since Vitruvius attempted to bring together his 10 scrolls to develop, as he said, all the principles of the discipline, with the conviction that an architect should know writing, literas, both to, quote, secure more lasting remembrance through his treatise, in other words, to be remembered. You have to be remembered in writing as well as in building, and to balance the knowledge of mere manual skill. Now, it's very interesting that at the moment when the first attempt to build a comprehensive theory of architecture is attempted, that writing, that the theory of architecture becomes an important half, if you like, of a discipline which, as he says, is without authority if it's without thinking and theory and writing, and without any base in making, without an understanding of the technology of the work itself. So it's an interesting attempt, Vitruvius's attempt, and we know it's a very heterogeneous book. Vitruvius was, as Alberti pointed out, somewhat caustically an engineer without much literas of his own, writing very bad engineer's Latin, but he cobbled together what he could find of Greek precepts, of Greek and early Roman and middle Roman precepts, together with an enormous amount of knowledge that he had gained on the on the warpath with Caesar. Out of the Caesar's wars, then, this engineer writes a book in order to encourage his adoption as a chief architect for Augustus, who is about to expand his empire. So right there in the center, the siege engines described by Vitruvius become that armature which gives theory and architectural making a place in the war economy of ancient Rome. And moving towards the Renaissance, of course, we find Alberti writing for the warlords of central Italy, a text which will, in fact, instruct them as the importance of architecture in the development not only of their defenses, but also the development of their fame and the development of their economies and the development of their pride. Filarete with the Sforza family, Alberti with the Medici family, we have the same relationship between architecture and war and architectural theory developed as a fundamental armature of a new economy, a mercantile economy based on a war footing. So the treatises from Alberti to Palladio to Barbaro to Cesariano through to Palladio, all in one way or another construct an architectural theory, which is an authorization of practice, and at the same time a way of understanding the architect's place in the world, or making understood the architect's place in the world through. And here I think Patrick's understanding in his Autopoiesis book of architecture as fundamentally to do with the act of drawing is correct. When you read Filarete's letter to the Sforza family on architecture, which has a postface, an essay on drawing, the whole book is taken up with teaching the young Sforza, the young Prince of Milan, how to draw, and therefore how to understand the architect's drawing as the primary role of the architect, who then passes that drawing on to he who builds. So drawing becomes important from the very start. And of course, in the 17th century, Pepo translates Vitruvius. Vitruvius is given one more leg of life through the academies of France and incorporated into the teaching manuals of the 18th and 19th centuries. So theory moves from the comprehensive treatise to the teaching manual and also to the style manual, from Blondel's teaching manual of the course of architecture to the repertoire of historical building types of Durand, to the style manuals of classical and Gothic architecture, culminating in Villers-le-Duc. So the treatise, the teaching manual, the style manual, and then, of course, in the early 20th century, the manifesto. So now theories of architecture are no longer comprehensive. They are agitprop, developed in such a way as to place in your face on the front page of the newspaper the new architecture, the new spirit, the new mechanistic civilization. And as you know, reading the Futurist Manifesto, it is an act of war as well as an act of war on architecture. It celebrates war. It celebrates, as you know, the power of masculinity embodied in the new technologies of warfare. And it is based on the notion that war will cleanse, war will erase, war will find the tabula rasa that architecture needs to construct for itself in order to be triumphant. A little less futurist, but still imbued with the futurist moment, comes this very strange book. Somewhere between a manifesto on the page that opens every chapter in this book, there's a little manifesto and a treatise of architectural form and formulation inserted into those chapters, partly a treatise on the relationship between design and architecture, design in the other arts of shipbuilding, of aircraft and automobile design, and design in terms of the forms that will then come to control architecture according to the same principles. So in that way, we find the modernist canon, so to speak, as it was received by the end of the 1930s by the international community and somehow embodied in that extremely pervasive and influential book, The International Style, written by Philip Johnson and Henry Russell Hitchcock for the Museum of Modern Art's exhibition of that title in 1932. The modernism is codified as a style, as having a basis in partly a treatise, partly a manifesto, and is ready to be incorporated, until the war intervened, into the smooth corporate development of American industry and society. The generation that graduated from architecture schools in the decade following World War II was a generation in search of new principles for architecture itself. In the shadow of the modern masters, there's that wonderful 1965 edition of Architectural Design with a photograph of Korb and Mies on the front talking to each other, edited by Peter Smithson, where he actually goes page by page, decade by decade, through the modern movement in order somehow to exorcise for his generation the shadow and the heavy weight of dealing with these modern masters. Others, a younger generation like James Stirling, will actually find in Ronchon and in the vernacular style adopted by Le Corbusier after the war, will find a strange rupture with the supposed rationalism of modernism and will attempt to find other languages. But the question is, how do you deal with these monsters that are in the room, these elephants that are in the room called Korb, Mies, Aalto, and before that, Frank Lloyd Wright? But also, this generation was critical of the social and urban effects of international style modernism, yet reluctant to abandon a commitment to modern architecture. And they looked in different ways, either for continuity through more or less radical revision, or to avoid in some way or another the crisis that they realized had been produced by the war. A political crisis in Italy. I mean, Ernesto Rogers reboots Casabella, calling it Casabella Continuita, that is, continue, right? But continue in a slightly different way, because you have to also break with that crisis of fascism. So the crisis and continuity debate occurs all the way through the 50s and 60s. It's absolutely pervasive. If you read any of Tafuri's essays from the 60s on, he opens them with, are we dealing with crisis or continuity in relationship to the architecture he's discussed? So the values of continuity then opposed to other avant-garde crisis of form, but continuity that enclosed the seeds of change. In Britain, the crisis was less political, with Labour winning the first post-war election. But if continuity was to be sought, it was a sense of the need for a tougher, a more accentuated response to the soft modernism of Sweden or the polished corporate styles emerging in the US. This was the moment, of course, of the angry young men who wanted room at the top and who basically, coming out of a different social elites, so to speak, than architecture had emerged before the Second World War, were struggling to find a rather strong definition, both personally and professionally, for an architecture. Thus, for example, the adoption of the word brutalism in relationship to the first efforts of the Smithsons. In this search, and here we talk about how theory emerges in a society, in this search, architects were supported by the surprising catholicity of the Architectural Review, its editorial board. Despite the individual sensibilities of Hugh de Cronin Hastings, Gordon Cullen, Eric de Marais, and Nicholas Pevsner, the journal hosted debates over questions as diverse as those posed by Colin Rowe's Palladianizing of Le Corbusier, and Eric de Marais' attempt to revitalize the canon in his survey of Scandinavian, British, American, and Russian ideas, Banham's New Brutalism, and Gordon Cullen's outrage over townscape environments supported by de Cronin Hastings' own crusade for a new picturesque. Indeed, the Architectural Review seemed open to all comers at the same time as proposing a fairly consistent editorial position against what Pevsner called the new historicism and for de Cronin's campaign for a comprehensive adoption of townscape. On its signature blue, brown, and sometimes yellow paper inserts, contrary visions of what might be principal post-war architectures were posed and refuted, often by the editors themselves. The stage was set, as we see on the screen, by the editor's introduction of the January 1947 issue of the Architectural Review. J.M. Richards, Nicholas Pevsner, Osbert Lancaster, and Hugh de Cronin Hastings celebrated the opening of the second half of the century. And they opened with a bold statement of policy. The second half century. The modern movement in architecture, they wrote, was now finally accepted as being made of very stern stuff indeed, this freeing the review to widen its scope. Side by side with the obligation to provide a third program for architecture. Do you still have the third program in England? The third program in England, the BBC third program, was the radio program for the elites. Radio it was three. The, what? Radio 3. Okay, third program. And, you know, Banham would talk on the third program, Pevsner would talk on the third program, they would all talk on the third program. So they wanted the review to be a third program for architecture, but equally strong, its equally strong mission to educate the public in the art of architecture, an act, as they said, in the cause of visual culture. And that's one of the main themes of my talk today. Visual culture is the foundation of this new understanding of architectural theory in the post-war. What that meant was made clear by a reference to the great visual educator, Ubdale Price, a model for the understanding of the visual experience bound by to the pursuit of the visual life presented in Landscape and Townscape. This is one of the earliest uses of the notion of townscape. The first half century, they wrote, although it's easy to identify Pevsner as a prime author, had seen the drama of the modern movement. This was then summarized in an imaginary two acts, in a pictorial resume, Act 1, where Ruskin Morris and the arts and crafts movement had prepared the ground, had been followed by Act 2, which traced the natural development of new visual symbols and the acceptance of new visual building techniques. Pevsner argued that now a third act was needed in order to bring true visual principles to technological expression. This act would bring back that most English of English traditions, the picturesque, studied now not only in terms of landscape design, but in relation to the new problems of urban landscape. And I have to say that a lot of my understanding of the picturesque in England at this time is taken from a student of the AA and of Mark Cousins, John MacArthur, who is now teaching in Australia, and whose book on the picturesque is probably the best contemporary treatment of the picturesque then and now. This act, the act of reinstating the picturesque, would reinstate the main plot, to recapture the scope and richness discarded by the modern revolution and to work for rehumanization, the building up of tradition, a new richness and differentiation of character, the pursuit of differences rather than sameness, the reemergence of monumentality, the cultivation of idiosyncrasy, and the development of those regional dissimilarities that people have always taken a pride in. Architecture, Pevsner concluded, must find a way of humanizing itself as regards expression without in any way abandoning the principles on which the modern movement revolution was founded. Very straightforward, but quite complex. Modern architecture had been dominated by planning, one coordinated scene, but had not yet acquired a visual three-dimensional status, nor the new scale that landscape element had introduced into architecture had been fully assimilated. The visual, said Pevsner, allows for a continuity of tradition. That historic precedent can be used constructively and not as an escape. And this was something that all the architects of that generation assimilated and incorporated into their work, from the more abstract assimilation of historic precedent with the Smithsons to the more literal historical precedent and assimilation of architects like Stirling. In this assertion of principle were bound up all the complex strands that were to preoccupy the architectural review over the next 30 years. The dedication to visual experience, the identification of such experience with the themes buried in the English picturesque tradition, and the demand to make these themes both pertinent and graphically visible to the public at large. And the seeds of what Pevsner himself will observe some 14 years later, and not without some dismay, as the return of historicism, which then became, of course, the postmodernism which Charles Jencks celebrated so strongly in what he called postmodern movement architecture. These third act principles had already been developed 3 years before by Hastings writing as the editor in February 1944 under the title Exterior Furnishing or Sharawagi, the Art of Making Urban Landscape. Here Hastings harked back to the time of Ebenezer Howard and Raymond Unwin and the effort to allow, this is a beautiful phrase, the effort to allow Billy Brown, the little man, and Bill Brown, the working man, to live a decent life in decent surroundings. This also was the social mission of the elite editorial board. Whence derived the image of a popular picture of the semi-Tudor, an image that still maintained traction some 50 years later. Andrew Ballantyne has just produced a beautiful and very witty book on the Tudor style in as it emerged and expanded across the suburban landscape in America and England in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. Hastings noted that England was no longer looked to as head of the international aspiration to architecture as it had been in the time of the arts and crafts movement. Planners had failed to provide an alternative picture comparable in realism, vividness, or simplicity to the Tudor model, while the technological or transportation-based model of the culture could not hold the Browns, who want a picture of the kind of world the physical planner will make, and up to date, he's been given nothing between Port Sunlight and Mars, M-A-R-S, the modern movement group in England. There was, Hastings argued, a serious need for a picture, literally a picture, that would reconcile visually in the mind's eye what appear to be irreconcilable elements in any town plan, quaint bits, new bits, monuments, traffic, tall buildings, short buildings, flat blocks, individual cottages, etc. So we needed a picture that could bring all this together to make the Billy Brown and Bill Brown happy. Thus he advanced a solution, picturesque theory, as it evolved in England in the 18th century and was internationalized in the early 19th. What we really need to do now, he suggested, was to resurrect the true theory of the picturesque and apply a point of view already existing to a field in which it has not been consciously applied before, the city. He admitted that this would demand a revolution in taste and therefore supplied a photo essay as a means of developing the elements of this revived theory. Photographs illustrated the idea of the street picturesque, the liveliness of the picturesque street, whose chimneys, odd roof angles, producing bows, trees and shrubs, chiaroscuro, some distant eye catcher closing the vista, constitute a genuine piece of urban landscape, the old and the new, as a contrast of complementarities, the success and failure of accident as opposed to the visual laissez-faire which reproduced a mining camp and not an urban landscape. In a masterstroke of retrospective nostalgia, Hastings concluded by taking as his model for such a theory that of Uberdale Price, Richard Payne Knight, as described in Christopher Hussey's classic study, The Picturesque. The art of landscape picturesque was, he claimed, identical to what the Chinese called sharawagi, or irregular gardening. Landscape should be observed with a painter's eye. Claude Lorrain, Salvatore Rosa, John Piper, John Nash, Edward Borden, Eric Revilius, Christopher Wood, Kenneth Rowntree, painters of urban scenery against those who see the New Jerusalem all open space and concrete. This was followed by a series of dialectic photographs that would lead, he hoped, to a visual policy for the urban landscape, one that was natural to the English temperament. He concluded, any time he so desires, the modern town planner is free to pick up picturesque theory at the point before its corruption by the Gothic revival, pick up the theory, rediscover its profits, and apply the principles. So now we have, in 1944, before the notion of Pevsner's second act, the theory of the picturesque. Perhaps the most dramatic, even shocking, of these early appeals to the picturesque had in fact been published as early as 1941, just after the conclusion of the first wave of the London Blitz. And this is where my understanding of this theory coming out of the war emerges. The Architectural Review published an article entitled somewhat provocatively, The Architecture of Destruction. The artist John Piper wrote the introduction as he sketched his impression of London's still smoking ruins. Roads blocked, warehouses still burning. The article was illustrated by photographs of the bombed out shells of churches and offices taken the morning after the raid. A sea of smoking rubble, wrote Piper. These terrifying images were accompanied, however, by a surprising commentary. The, quote, transparent shell of a corner building exhibits, quote unquote, drama. Paternoster Square and Ave Maria Lane are seen as, quote, examples of the surprising proportions of air raid scenery. The north of St. Paul's has been transformed into a grotto. Stone calcinated by fire has, quote, a peculiar quality, the striking motifs of the windowless arcades. The article ended by enthusiastically noted, quote, the surprising poetry of destruction, the oddity of a newly bombed interior, and the almost gaiety, like a scene in a French film, of a garden in next morning's sunshine. These were ruins looked at, quote, with an artist's eye, as architecture in their own right, exhibiting, quote, an intensive, evocative atmosphere, unquote, to be admired, quote, frankly, for their own beauty. In this way, the editors of the review saw the picturesque effects of the new ruins allied to what Edmund Burke had called the terrifying sublime. What de Cronin Hastings was calling visual education was here advanced with a vengeance. These articles were anticipate many, devoted to, on the one hand, to the theory of the picturesque, and on the other, to the complementary theory of townscape. Hastings, under the, second slide from the Poetics of Destruction, and the townscape. Hastings, under the pseudonym Ivor de Wolf, wrote on townscape, basing his theory on Uwedel Price's essay on the picturesque, as we've seen, prefacing the first pictorial essay by Gordon Cullen, entitled Townscape Casebook, the beginning of Cullen's powerful role as a popular illustrator of these principles. Pevsner also wrote on the picturesque, claiming that the modern movement itself had its roots in the picturesque aesthetic, and demonstrating his thesis by reference to Le Corbusier's informal grouping of houses at Stuttgart, at the Siedlung. Hastings' article on townscape was equally unambiguous. He wrote, the movement that used to be called functionalism has developed an inner schism in which one party, figurehead Le Corbusier, has moved towards the rational or classic or crystalline solution, the other, figurehead Frank Lloyd Wright, towards the romantic or, as he would say, organic. There's a third movement, so far not isolated by the critics, that might be called the English or radical, since it neither belongs to any of the above categories. The war cry irregular needs a casebook, like the casebook of common law. An aesthetic theory had now been presented with the claim that modernism, because it was actually picturesque, was as English as the common law of the country. That such a theory was implicitly counter-modern, if not postmodern, was demonstrated by the furious response of Alan Colquhoun in a letter responding to Pevsner's claim that Le Corbusier was influenced by the picturesque. Colquhoun retorted, nonsense. that Pevsner's Le Corbusier was an entirely visual fabrication, owing nothing to the irrational, internal, ideational content of the architecture. But we should remember that Colquhoun was himself working out of the image of a Le Corbusier fashioned by Cullen Rowe in his Mathematics of the Ideal Villa, A Mannerism of Modern Architecture, 1947 and 1949 in the Architectural Review. That of a modernist manipulating the geometries of Palladian plans and the imbricated techniques of Mannerist facades within a vocabulary of purist abstraction. The moment of opposition between what was seen as picturesque townscape and the Palladian revival, however, stimulated by Witkowa's architectural principles and influenced the early work of Peter and Alison Smithson, was brief. The Smithsons said it was over by 1948. And today, the oppositional nature, as we shall see, of Rowan Curtis' collage city to townscape seems less abrupt. Indeed, as John MacArthur has recently demonstrated, the similarities between a visual theory of urban composition from ground level, Cullen's townscape, and the visual theory based on aerial photography and figure ground plans, collage city, are more striking than their differences. In this context, it was entirely logical to find Robert Venturi's first article published under the rubric Townscape in the May 1953, this was before Venturi became Venturi, issue of Architectural Review. Entitled The Campidoglio, a Case Study, Venturi's thesis was entirely visual and concerned with the way in which the character of Michelangelo's formalizing of the Campidoglio had been injured by ignorance of the principle that, quote, the architect has a responsibility towards the landscape, which he can subtly enhance or impair, for we see in perceptual holes, and the introduction of any new building will change the character of all the other elements in the scene. Venturi, in a sequence of figure ground plans and sections, demonstrated the point. Michelangelo had modified the piazza so that the original senatorial palace was given emphasis by the contrasting elements of the flanking buildings, color, texture, and the neutral, even rhythm of their columned facades. The introduction of the huge monumental structure of the monument to Vittorio Emanuele, a shiny monster, had destroyed the setting with its intricate small-scale neighborhoods, and thus the effect of the ascent to the Campidoglio itself, ending in the powerfully visual controlled piazza, as well as the view from the piazza, which formally offered views tantalizingly interrupted with that rich, unaffected architectural foregrounds. A wrecking crew could hardly have damaged it more, Venturi concluded. Here we can see the transition from the visual theory of townscape to that of postmodern taking place quite easily and early. And when in 1966 Venturi finally published the work that he had begun in 1954 in Rome, the shift was to be complete. Under the guise of returning to an original autonomy for architecture, Venturi cataloged the ways in which contemporary architecture might regain some of the richness seemingly lost through modernist abstraction, using all the techniques employed by Hastings, Pevsner, and Cullen to revive the visual complexity and contrast of the urban scene, now to restore visual complexity to the single building. It was as a direct response to the purely visual theories of townscape that a number of architectural theorists tried once more to regain the sense of a discipline. Beginning with John Summerson's appeal for a program, as Banham is on the left, Pevsner's in the middle, and Summerson's on the right. As a fundamental source of unity for modern architecture, he drew his inspiration from Mahalyanaji's sense of a new biologically grounded formal aesthetic. Rainer Banham's stock taking of 1960, which called which followed his 1955 New Brutalism essay, which called for an architecture autre, and stock taking of 1960 on the right hand page, on the right hand side of this, in this slide, actually on yellow paper with a bright red spot, 1960, which called for a new technological basis derived from cybernetics and computer science. And Peter Eisenman's first forays into formalism in 1963, 3 years later, publishing his call for a formal basis of modern architecture in architectural design, the pressures for a rigorous and unified theory intensified. By the late 1960s, however, a second post-war generation was concerned to counter these positions again, constituted around the traditional divisions of function, technology, and form as they were. It's very interesting that Summerson takes utilitas, Banham takes fermitas, and Eisenman takes venustas. This was a new generation that had a sense with what Banham had called, hopefully, un architecture autre, was not to be found in any new formalisms, but by the reframing of the discourse through technology and social science. Architectural design took the lead in this, under the editorship of Monica Pidgeon and Theo Crosby, and later Kenneth Crampton, supporting the Smithson and their allies in Team 10, but also such widely disparate positions as those of Cedric Price, of Archigram, as well as those of John Turner with his reports from Lima, spearheading investigations into the potential reconstruction of the barrios, or in the world ecological consciousness of John McHale, who edited a special issue of 1967 on 2000+, reviewing the state of the world resources and anticipating his seminal book, The Future of the Future and the Ecological Context. You can read this book, The Ecological Context, which was published in 1971 today, as if it were an immediate and present indictment of the questions that assail us in terms of environmental sustainability, environmental control, and environmental chaos. As Beatrice Colomina and her colleagues have made it clear in the book Clip Stamp Fold, a book and exhibition devoted to the little magazines of the 60s and 70s, by the late 60s, theory had been co-opted by a proliferation of these little magazines, representing an increasing radicalized generation intent on countering the conformist axioms of the profession. Even architectural design was transformed into a hip broadsheet with its signature section Cosmorama, started in 1969 when Peter Murray joined Robin Middleton as art editor and began the wild ride to the architectural equivalent of the Whole Earth Catalog. Here, the movement to the environmental, ecological, and social issues was clear. Casabella, on the other hand, under the editorship of Mendini, was supportive of groups Banham contrast of the traditional modernist architecture with technological aspirations and the technological architecture of exactly the same year, 1929-30, by Buckminster Fuller, embraced by McHale, who then worked with Fuller. Mendini, however, was supportive of groups like Super Studio and Archizoom, who purported to stand apart from architecture and critique it with these extraordinarily dystopian visions. Archigram published its own journal, as we've seen, as did Jean Hubert and Hubert Tonker in Utopie in France. In total opposition, yet fascinated by the potentials of architecture to inflect society, Guy Debord and his friends published the International Situationiste from 1958 on with their definitions of the new urbanism. These counter-architectural movements were balanced during the 1960s and 70s by a series of appeals to renew the language and spirit of architecture itself after the perceived barrenness of the hegemonic international style. That's Venturi, obviously, Paolo Portoghesi, and so on. All these movements developed manifestos. But around 68, and not necessarily as a result of the revolutions of that year, things theoretical seem to change. Architecture, rather than the subject discussed by architects and architectural theorists, however much against architecture they were, became a subject of interest from outside. The big shift in the late 60s is that architectural theory shifted from being developed from inside architecture to appeal outside and to develop its own understandings, to looking outside architecture for a theorization of its own discipline. Architecture, rather than a subject discussed by architects and architectural theorists, became a subject of interest from outside, from philosophy, epistemology, linguistics, and most importantly, politics. With the Marxist critique of institutions, from Althusser to Lefebvre, architecture already under attack from the right and the left for its apparent failure to address the social problems of the post-war period, became an object of inquiry as an ideology, similar to those identified in Marxist theory, law, religion, the state. Architecture, now understood in Althusser's terms as an ideological state apparatus and thereby an instrument of state power. It was a moment fueled not by the role of architecture in representing or constructing the state, or aestheticizing capital, the foundation of all theories of architecture, but equally now by the politics of resistance that emerged in the opposition to the Algerian and Vietnam wars, to the neoliberal capitalist governments of the post-war period, and to the consumer cultures of the 1950s and 60s that threatened to depoliticize the class and ethnic struggles of post-colonialism. This argument was advanced on the far left by the institutional critiques of Foucault and reinforced by the textual critiques of Roland Barthes and Jacques Derrida. In a move towards what today might be called media theory, Pierre Bourdieu, Jean Baudrillard, and Paul Virilio analyzed the relations of architecture to representation, traditional cultures, technology, and social mobility. The most effective of those interventions within architecture itself was perhaps that of Foucault, whose investigation of the disciplinary discourse was centered on institutions that had developed significant architectural typologies since the 18th century, asylums, hospitals, prisons, and whose writings from 65 to 74 inspired both critics and architects to rethink the idea of typology as an architectural and urban level. These texts were taken up by architectural theorists, not as before as supplements to the design process itself, anthropologists and sociologists acting as humanizing influence on the theories of Team 10, for example, but rather as invitations to rewrite the theory of the discipline. Thus, to give some examples out of many, Foucault's History and Epistemology of the Institutional Discourse, Asylums, Hospitals, Prisons, launched a wholesale critique in architecture over the nature of power and its sources, hidden and overt. Barthes' essays on semiology introduced architects to the structural analysis of buildings and city-states as communication devices. Derrida's deconstruction of philosophical and literary texts led architectural theorists to question the commonplaces of their own practice. Deleuze's study of Leibniz and the Baroque precipitated interest in the typologies of folding. Here, a very interesting comparison. This is the diagram that Deleuze drew in his book on Leibniz, in his book on the fold, which is about Leibniz's understanding of the operations of senses in developing ideas in the brain. And you see that his diagram of the Leibniz's house is actually taken from his reading of Werfen's Renaissance and Baroque. It's actually not the interior of a house, but the facade of a Baroque church. And of course, Lacan's rereading of Freud, allowing for a new understanding of the relations between the visual gaze and desire. In each case, the intent of the transmigration of theories from outside to inside was to unpack the verities of the procession and disclose the hidden ideological agendas behind apparently innocent practices. And I think probably the most effective, the strongest effect of those theoretical interventions was felt by Rem Koolhaas and Bernard Schumi, among others. And I want to emphasize this because there's been a great deal of conversation in the United States, certainly about the notion of a post-theoretical or post-critical generation that is not interested in reading theory. And to me, it's not surprising, given that the theories that were developed outside architecture, and specifically the theories of on the left of Marx, of the Marxists on the left and Foucault, were in fact fundamentally against disciplines as a whole, as ideological constructions of power by the state, and therefore against the notion of architecture existing at all, and actually produced no understanding for a whole generation of architects of how to do architecture, of how to produce anything from architecture. They were not productive theories. They were literally deconstructive theories, and left a whole generation of students and architects with the sort of weak, I think, the very weak manner of trying to illustrate those theories in certain ways rather than incorporating a theory of production out of their theory of deconstruction. It was in reaction against this overt fragmentation of the architectural body that a number of critics called once more for a comprehensive and overarching theory. Tafuri explained it in 68, It's symptomatic, he wrote, in fact, that there is a demand from many quarters for the establishment of a rigorous theoretization of architectural problems. This need is felt by a considerable number of English-speaking critics, particularly by Collins, by a historian like Christian Norberg Schultz, by specialists of planning methods like Christopher Alexander and Asimov, by theorists involved in planning like Aldo Rossi and Giorgio Grassi. And so we have, in the mid-1960s, an attempt to rebuild architectural theory comprehensively. Christian Norberg Schultz tried to bind the body back together again in a long drawn out assemblage of observations on almost every aspect of architectural thought, historical, semiological, programmatic, technological, and above all, phenomenological. Experience was the key and balance the method. Tafuri balanced the method. This coherence was to be achieved, Norberg Schultz claimed later, by introducing the phenomenological theory of architecture, this time joined to the newly popular and restored to post-war legitimacy, Heideggerian vision of holism, and of course Norberg Schultz in existence, space, and architecture tries to assimilate this holistic theory of Heidegger's little Hütte there, and there we have the way we ought to live, Heidegger and his bucket. As we know, Rossi and the neo-rationalists were to take a more structuralist position, influenced by the structural anthropology of Claude Lévi-Strauss, attempting to link the underlying structure of the traditional city to developing typologies of the contemporary. It was in 1975, finally, there we have Rossi's analogous city, pasting together all the images and typologies of present cities. And it was in 1975, finally, that the apparently opposed visions of Townscape and Rowe's version of modernist collage came together in the seminal article, again published by the Architectural Review, Collage City, anticipating the exercise of reformulating the figure ground plan of Rome in the Roma Interrata exhibition of 1978. It's very interesting to contrast the article Collage City, which has most of the text of the book Collage City, with how the reception of that article then transformed the text of the book, Collage City, the article actually is a lot fresher and more lively than the book itself, which became, I think, very over-edited. Some photographs from that article, Collage City, contrasting the expressionists to the classical idealists of the Renaissance, and the Roma Interrata exhibition, which in fact celebrated Collage City by producing a collage of 12 panels of the Noli map put together from 12 architects. By 1980, the pictorial re-envisioning of historical architecture, characterized by Paolo Portoghesi's reenactment of architecture without inhibitions, as he called it, in the Strada Novissima at the Venice Biennale, had confirmed Pevsner's early suspicions that a new historicism was in the air, but in a flamboyant manner far from Pevsner's imagining. And that, I guess, ended in that. These initiatives, however different in form, were in the event all based on the idea that architecture, more than anything else, was a visual art, experienced through vision and communicating its effects and meaning visually. And if you actually look through Charles Jencks' Architecture 2000 and look at the various categories, 80% of the categories that are listed there are visual categories, not programmatic categories. All pretense of adherence to any newly formulated programs, such as those posed by Summerson, was abandoned. Perhaps the only real difference between Townscape and Collage, as I've mentioned, was that Townscape viewed the city from the ground, Google Street, while Collage viewed it from the air, Google Earth. The brief counter-movement, so-called deconstructivist, in a strange but catchy neologism between deconstruction and constructivist, fabricated by Philip Johnson and Mark Wigley, was however equally visual in its processes, whether in plan or three dimension, as it sought to demonstrate an antipathy to any classical or modernist forms of composition, but a complete conservatism in terms of the program. Only the presence of Rem Koolhaas not very appropriately situated among these exhibitors, gave the sense that programmatic argument leading to a reformulation of typology and precedent within a deliberate and ironic reframing of the modernist debate between Le Corbusier and Nice gave one the sense that more than the visual outcome could be expected from this movement. Rem's later transformation of Townscape into the concept of junk space was the last nail in the coffin for a purely visual approach to architectural theory. Save, perhaps, in the more recent attempts to theorize the productions of an increasingly sophisticated digital architecture, from the animate architecture of Greg Lynn to the parametric autopoiesis of Patrick Schumacher. Here we're given once more the sense that a comprehensive theory of architecture is possible, one now based on the apparently all-encompassing systems of modeling and iteration produced by parametric programs. For Lynn, who has coupled his research into the production of newly topologically defined surfaces with a research into the new material fabrication methods of boat building and sail making, the synthesis is now between mapping and fabrication. For Schumacher, the potential goes even further in order to herald an entirely new style of architecture that adapts naturally to the ever-changing complexities of the social and economic system. In both, however, the result is judged visually. In Lynn's case, by the conviction that Baroque forms are better than the minimalist forms of the earlier modernity. In Schumacher's case, by the theoretical conviction that in the end, all architecture can be defined according to the rules of its style. In both, architecture retains a certain autonomy of form, only to be subsumed beneath the process of a technologically driven system society. The problem, of course, is that what actually drives architecture and has driven architecture for millennia is entirely ignored, or rather accepted as given, or as so given as to be irrelevant, the economy. And more importantly, these theories ignore the fact that all new architectures have been and probably will be for the foreseeable future born out of war economies. Vitruvius out of the Gallic Wars, proposing a systematization of the discipline to help Augustus expand the empire. Alberti and Filarete appealing to their princely warlords by reference to the grandeur of ancient Rome. Le Corbusier out of the First World War working to divert the production processes of the Voisin Aircraft Company. The digital revolution of the present emerging for the Second World War machine and continually refined in the ongoing wars of the present. Architecture, I'm prepared to predict, will no longer have to assert its autonomy at all. It will soon be theorized as the drone it already is for the neoliberal capital takeover of the world economy. Thank you. What?
Can you do a couple of questions?
Yeah.
That's
fair.
Thank you, Tony, very much. Should we do some questions?
Any? Not that I can answer many. A short warning against too much comprehensive theory, and an appeal for a little bit of resistance to what makes and drives most architecture. Yes.
Well, it's a short question.
Okay.
I was just wondering if you could elaborate a bit more about the function of pleasure through the theoretical tracing you've provided.
Well, I think the function of pleasure was brought very fundamentally into the discourse by the Situationists. Guy Debord and his friends had read Huitzinger's treatise on the idea of mankind as always involved in some form of festival, as fundamentally geared towards pleasure, if you like. You have to deal with Freud a little bit, where pleasure is always countered, as Mark Cousins will tell you, by a certain sort of other eruption of principles that are not immediately apparent. But pleasure, of course, has to be defined, if you're talking about visual pleasure, has to be defined in terms of a dominating culture, which is often defined in relationship to much more broad media and visual culture in the world outside. Hence, for example, the comfort that a little Tudor, you know, semi-detached gives visual pleasure to a particular culture where that is identified both nostalgically and romantically as something comfortable, right, and therefore pleasurable. So visual pleasure, I think, is not to be identified with anything absolute in the sense of a Kantian absolute. It's to be identified always with a media culture. It's very obvious that the forms and shapes of digital architecture are deeply connected to, if they give pleasure, right? Are deeply connected to the forms and shapes of video games, which are deeply connected to the forms and shapes of those experimental war games which are used to train troops on the ground. So there's a continuing relationship, I think, between that which commands the media at every point, at every moment, that which the images which are disposed by the media and what people see as interesting, good, pleasurable, or visually satisfying, right? So you know, the fact, and that, you know, relates to taste. It relates to you know, consumer attractions and so on. So I'm very worried about simply talking about pleasure in relationship to the production of architecture. If you produce architecture for the pleasure of one group, you're certainly going to displease another group, and certainly within the short terms of consumer culture pleasure, you're going to, you know, I mean, think of how quickly quote-unquote brutalism became, you know, eschewed and ignored and hated, and how quickly it's becoming re-adopted into a rather, you know, nostalgic, canonical vision, right? So I think those kinds of questions are part of cultural history, right? But not necessarily a part of the intentional processes to either resist the overarching forces of capital production, or to even reform it.
Could I go back to the beginning of the lecture when you're making the kind of claim really about the pressure of warfare kind of on the whole architectural history? And I'm thinking kind of in a sense, how can one frame warfare, you know, in terms other than the way it's framed by the military?
Right.
So that, as it were, one has a notion of what you're saying, but outside terms of wars,
right,
or whatever.
Right.
It does seem to me that what you're describing, and it's sort of slightly difficult to get at, but is a fundamental reorganization of the relationship between the normal and the exceptional.
Mm-hmm.
That is to say, we used to think that there was something called the normal on the surface of things. Perhaps underneath there was something else which might erupt as an emergency. That might be war, it might be the breakdown of a constitution, it might even be the breakdown of an individual.
Or a natural disaster.
Or a natural disaster.
Right.
But somehow these two are kind of counterpositioned. Now, it seems to me what is characterizing the sort of emergence of what you're talking about is when the normal and the kind of emergency no longer obey that, and they get, they're all, as it were, woven into one.
The new normal.
I mean, at the legal level, we have exceptional legal states.
Right.
We always did. They were called things like martial law. But now they're part of the normal constitutional state in the way that the states can actually hold Guantanamo Bay under a condition which it calls normal,
right,
if you see what I mean. So it's about the possibility that's been opened up is the sort of coexistence of the normal and the emergency or the exceptional.
Which was hidden for a certain amount of time after the Second World War, won by the refusal of Europe to really believe that wars that were operating in the Far East were deeply of concern to their civilization and culture. But of course brought home to us by the fact that despite the the old-fashioned capitalist assumption that wars create a boom economy. The last two wars that we've been involved in Afghanistan and Iraq have actually produced a vast recession.
Well, of course, and the Afghan war, the Iraq war, the previous kind of Middle East of the Kuwait, and indeed Vietnam itself, weren't actually wars in constitutional terms.
Quote, unquote, right.
They were never declared. They've been reconfigured.
In the old-fashioned sense,
into
they were
peace.
Not declared.
Yeah, they were not declared. So, I mean, it's this reconfiguration in which then states which architects once thought were in opposition become sort of absolutely adjacent, kind of Dubai with its homeless, etc.
No, absolutely. I agree. I mean, what I'm trying to say is that we can no longer write history as if we're innocent. And when I'm writing the history of theory and practice, one has to. It was extraordinary to me in the exhibition that Jean-Louis Cohen just closed at the Canadian Center in Montreal, which is called Architecture in Uniform. And it's a very good book that was produced out of that exhibition. All those hidden moments where you find that Kenzo Tange, for example, who built the memorial in Hiroshima as a peace memorial, the earlier memorials were to the conquest of the East, of Korea and China. And in the 1930s and 40s. So there's once you begin to see architectural practice as a whole, as opposed to the four or five monuments that are drawn out to exemplify architectural visual monumentality and creativity and iconicity, right? You begin to see a much more a practice that's much more deeply imbricated in the whole apparatus of state economy and interstate economy and war. Yeah. Yes.
In the late 1980s, there was a movement born right here at the AA called Narrative Architecture Today, and there was a critical Brian Hatton articulated some ideas about that, which were based on detournement, on the ideas of the international situationist. And I wondered whether you might take an account of how that's emerged today in various initiatives that one sees, perhaps in London, of groups doing what have been called pop-ups, or taking, rather than this very sleek, exquisite, digitalized way of making architecture, one which recycles, takes ruins, finds spaces under motorways, takes the situation of waste and rubbish and non-tabula rasa kind of building, and is also often a cooperative of some sort. I mean, I wonder if that offers a kind of counter to this kind of architecture.
It certainly does, and it seems to be increasingly, I would say, a positive movement towards the appropriation of spaces that are, forgotten or at least lost and reappropriated. As I was being very interested and excited and supportive of the occupation movement in the States, where again the public, quote unquote, public space, has been adopted by the public, and then, of course, the non-public, that is the police, the city state, has resisted in that occupation of public space in the name of the public. So I think these are extremely encouraging moments of resistance by different forces of resistance in society. I think there has to be a much more powerful, if you think of the vast amount of opposition to, say, Britain's intervention in Iraq, and a huge, I mean, we've never seen such demonstrations. I mean, even at the time of the campaign for nuclear disarmament, there weren't such big demonstrations. But, you know, how futile, right? How absolutely impossible has it been to stop this juggernaut? And what I find very dispiriting among theories that comprehensively try to absorb architecture into the technologies of whether it's digitalization or fabrication or, you know, I mean, architecture has always been subsumed into a technology, drawing, right? Stone cutting, I mean, it's always been there. But to subsume that as a totalization and therefore a normalized adaptation to the big forces that then support big buildings and big offices and big global expansions, I find that kind of a theory very difficult to take. When I find the word economy in the big white 400 pages of autopoesis on once and one paragraph on page 365, I find it a little difficult to understand the sensitivity of a theorist to the absorptive characterizations of digital architecture in the way in which it's being proposed. I mean, digital, you asked me whether, people would ask me the beginning of this moment whether I like the computer, whether I like digitalization. I said, you could draw horrors with a pencil, you know, and you can draw horrors with digitalization. You can also do some good things. You can do incredibly interesting analyses and penetrating analyses. I mean, when Hans Harker was asked to do a solo exhibit at the Guggenheim years and years ago, what he did was to do an analysis of the real estate holdings of the trustees of the Guggenheim and put them on a wall in a big chart. It was very quickly taken down, right? But that analysis, if done now, with all the kinds of network structures that are possible with computation, you could actually do quite a good job.
Could I ask you then, is it on? Could I ask you then to speak a little bit about the digitalization of discourse and and the location of discourse? I mean, we talked about in your lecture through the formats of book treaties, magazines, little magazines, and then exhibitions with Clips That Fold and Venice. So I just wanted to ask your thoughts about the location of discourse and the fact that a lot of that's taking place online.
Yes.
And there's economies in terms of immaterial labors and authority and validation in that framework.
Right. I mean, actually, Michael Hayes and I had a project about a couple of years ago to actually tweet each other and develop a Twitter theory of architecture. But we couldn't restrain ourselves to that 140 characters. It didn't work quite, you know, form, function, and then you lost the rest. Yes, I am all persuaded of the persuasive and the cumulative virtues of social media, right? I'm also persuaded of the demagogic powers of opinion as opposed to knowledge. And it seems to me, I was reading an article the other day about how someone who knew quite a lot about a particular Wikipedia entry was trying to change it, right? And the minute he changed it, it got changed back. And the minute he changed it, it got changed back. And the minute he changed it, it got changed back. Because even though he knew that what the Wikipedia article was saying was completely wrong, the Wikipedia rule is that the dominant version of facts is the rule, right? And he couldn't actually produce, even though this guy had done, 10 years of research to demonstrate that this was, but he was only one voice, right? And he didn't have, hundreds of voices supporting his version of the facts, whereas all the books that were written about this particular event were, wrong. So it, and you know very well the kinds of terrifying things that can happen to people and about people on the internet in different ways. So I'm yes, I'm very happy about the possibilities of a directed, theoretical discussion, critical discussion, or a sort of an oppositional discussion, right? But I am deeply aware of the demagogic possibilities of crowds and the demagogic possibilities of opinion. And I'm actually still, in a very old-fashioned way, on the side of knowledge, right? Which is backed up by something that you can actually demonstrate.
I was thinking simply on a similar line, so to ask a question about the moment where you start your project on the, let's say, the rise of the post-war culture of architectural theory is also a moment that shifts away from, let's say, in the first half of the 20th century, architectural history is being written by singular individuals with very interesting individualist views, Gideon or otherwise, right, of how architecture was shaped, to not just a new kind of platform, which arguably the magazine is, but a new way of working on theory, which is, of course, amongst an editorial board of quite informed, educated individuals that are in conversation with one another. And it's not, strictly speaking, a rock and roll model, let's say, of the 1960s with the rise of the supergroup, but it's certainly a different way of practicing work on the concept.
A rock and roll model could be fun.
I think you were one of the guys in the opposition's editorial group when you were brought together at Storefront, I remember, said it felt a bit like being the Beatles for a moment. The four of you were brought together to talk about a journal that's being shaped through the conversation between three or four minds. And in a way, your history
four
is
minds and the fifth Beatle, right?
No, but in a way, what you're sketching out is a history of the disillusion or the disappearance of that kind of activity and the rise of a monoculture, again, now dominated by singular, if it's online or otherwise, singular opinion makers who are simply shaping stories in a different form.
It's like talk radio,
very much.
And it's very, very hard. I mean, no matter how hard, for example, left groups or even Democrat politic groups in the United States try to launch counters to the right wing talk radio, it's impossible to counter because by the time you're always in response and react. It's always reactive as opposed to, because you can never be as nasty.
I had one other question prompted by the way you're sketching out the story now, which is that it seems very almost poignant to look back on the 1940s in this country and to see that, in fact, the theory of architecture was bound so tightly to the city, rightly or wrongly, in terms of its picturesque reinterpretation. The city and architecture were nonetheless understood as two sides of the same coin, which is certainly understandable in the rebuilding of London, let's say, and the rebuilding of countries across Europe after the war. By the 1970s, it seems, we're reaching a moment where any theory of architecture is breaking away from the city. And if we take, let's say, learning from Las Vegas, Collage City, Delirious, the last generation in which a theory of architecture is directly invested in a theory of the city.
Right.
And if that autonomy of architecture is a problem now because of its disconnect to the city, or if the problem lies in autonomy itself as a kind of discipline.
I think the tension is right there in Ross's Architecture in the City, because on the one hand, you're looking at the structural typology of an individual institution. And on the other hand, you're looking at the structure of a whole city. The two are not compatible, as you've seen with Ross's own architecture, which devolves into autonomous units that are almost sort of prefabricated in typological freeze-dried typologies, right? So I think the real question of, as the Italians used to say in the 60s, tipo morfo, right? Typology and morphology, and they were supposed to join together the typology of the building and the morphology of the city. The breakaway of the two, the concentration, actually, on institutional typologies that was stimulated by Foucault and his architectural researchers in France, I think did, in fact, and I have to say part of the problem there, it did, in fact, lead to, I think, an unfortunate concentration on the individual building as a typological unit, as opposed to the collective notion of the public realm and the city. And I think if one is to look at the city again, all the big books that come out on the the huge spread of urbanism in the world are about architecture and urbanism and the city and population as is, right? There are very few reimaginings of the territory of the world in terms of how such large conurbations, which no longer recognize any distinction between rural, the old rural city distinction, were very, very few, except I think rather caricatural operations in the desert, you know, in circular cities or whatever. There are very, very few prospective theories of how that rural urban conurbation, if you like, or it's no longer a megalopolis, it's a territory, it could be a state, could be actually understood as a problem for design. You know. As you said before, the Datascape didn't solve that problem. Yes.
Okay, thanks very much. I was especially struck by the way in which discourses about ecology start to emerge in the period that you're looking at, and the kind of subsequent fortunes and uses of those within architectural theory,
right,
within what you're describing as, I don't know if you can call it a project, but you say what you're looking at is the relationship between theory and architecture,
yeah,
the and next, neoliberalism.
Right. The next chapter is called Whatever Happened to Ecology.
Right, well, that's kind of precisely what I was concerned about.
Yeah.
To what extent do you understand that as very significant, in addition to understandings of visual perception?
Right.
Because to me, what seems to be happening is a massive kind of convergence where everything wants to understand itself and present itself as ecological and as life, that capital
right.
works according to the principles of life.
Right.
So does the economy, etc. So does architecture, and they kind of converge and affirm
right.
each other.
They do, and I'm worried about that convergence because I don't believe that everything that is developed under the sign now, under the sign of sustainability, under the sign of ecology, under the sign of green, right, is necessarily not absorbed within the apparatus that I'm trying to critique, right? The first thing. Second thing, I'm very interested about the fact that John McHale, this is an individual, started his life as a social scientist. He got his PhD in social science from London University, went to Paris, met some of the post-surrealist groups, came back, developed a very, very sophisticated collage art, and then met Fuller and moved into the map making and construction of indices for global warming in the 1960s and 70s. So that, and his visual art, his collages were very critical, they were very ironic, they were very playful, but they were also about something. They were not pure visual statements for pleasure, right? So I don't know. There is a moment where the visual and the ecological comes together. That's what I'm trying to say. And I think for McHale and Fuller, the visual was precisely a communicative device for something deeper and something more fundamental, like the Fuller map, for example. But I'm a little bit worried by this notion that of convergence, because I think that is very easily absorbed and defanged, if you like, by a kind of totalizing understanding of what is, and therefore what can be no different, right? So that worries me. It worries me that because we can now test heat loss and gain on any shape that we want to build, that we can build any shape because the intricacies of construction and lightweight materials and bonding and all the kinds of things we can build, we can do all that, right? That's not necessarily ecological, right? Not necessarily sustainable. And that's, to me, a question. I mean, how do you build a building which actually is a zero-sum game in relationship to carbon emissions? Right? how you come, right? So, but how do you then test the appropriateness of your single building or your complex of buildings to an environment in relationship to the whole environment, not just to, right? So I find all these things testable and explicable through analysis, but the actual the political question of why and then what and then how is subsumed in a kind of technological organicism, actually.
Yeah. Sorry, could I just make a comment on that? I mean, I think that's right, but that it seems to me that one of the problems that we have with ecology and indeed certain other kind of points of view is that in a sense, the easiest way of putting them is to use certain kind of quite conservative notions, like in a sense, nature.
Right.
So that, you know, it's not difficult for people to argue ecology on the grounds that we have trespassed too far on the resources of nature and we ought to back off
right.
in some kind of simple way. And it actually kind of has its strange kind of digital kind of parallel when you now have people kind of saying, in effect, that certain forms of designs, almost certain kind of preferred shapes, actually constitute a kind of mimesis of the natural. I mean, it's as if behind all this, there is a sort of shadow of the natural dragging back thought. Because in a sense, the ecology can no longer be supported by a divine or even human notion of nature, but has to accept that it's political. I mean, it seemed to me.
Well, and of course, it's no surprise to find that every single architectural theory in history always appealed to nature, whether Alberti is talking about a building as a horse, or you know, Vitruvius is talking about a column as a man. But
well, I think the very text you started with actually moves very much towards that position.
Yeah. And the way in which the misuse of the kind of phenomenological paradigm, you know, which is still very, very strongly rampant, allows us to say in a holistic way, right, that the Heidegger hut is actually the only end game that we can aspire to away from all this, right, because we can become one as psychic individuals with nature in our hut, but we still need that bucket.
I had a friend who visited the hut and said, actually, to cut to the chase very quickly, there's a sign now outside saying, private property, keep out.
Fantastic. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. Tony, thank you so much.